Why? Because إن الذين يؤذون الله ورسوله لعنهم الله في الدنيا والآخرة. Therefore, the first type of tabarra which is valid is a dua, which is known as la'na. That's why in ziyarat Ashura, when we say Allahumma al'an, for example, Yazid, Shimr bin Diljoshan, Ibn Ziyad, Ibn Marjana. Ibn Ziyad and Ibn Marjana are the same person. But purposely, Ibn Marjana, Marjana was the name of Ibn Ziyad's mother. She was included because if you go and examine what her profession was, you'll know why she was included. So what happens was Ibn Ziyad and Ibn Marjana. Here, when we give la'na on them, are we cursing them? No, it's not cursing. Cursing is the word which has been translated in the English language. It's not right. What we are doing is saying, Allahumma al'an Yazid, Allahumma al'an Shimr, Allahumma al'an Ibn Ziyad, meaning, Ya Allah, withdraw your mercy from the one who killed Aba Abdullah. Withdraw your mercy from the one who hurt the sisters of Aba Abdullah. When you are saying a la'na, you are asking Allah to withdraw the mercy. But a point should be noted on this area about la'na as a form of tabarra. The first point that should be noted in terms of la'na as a form of tabarra is the idea of what? Is the idea, why are you sending la'na on Yazid, for example? Why? Because Yazid was the type of person who used to listen to music. Isn't that why we send la'na? He was known to listen to music, and therefore he was a man who was immoral. I ask you one question. If you are doing the same thing, shouldn't the la'na rebound on you as well? Like, there are some of us who happily send la'na on Yazid. We have the same one of us in our cars. I cannot drive without listening. Look how low the human becomes. I cannot drive without listening. And you find in our bedrooms of our children, it's all right for them. We buy them an iPod. No problem, buy them the iPod, but check who's on there. As in, for all you know, you may be sending la'na on a personality in Islamic history when the la'na should be going towards you because you're acting the same way. I send la'na on Shimr bin al-Joshan. Why? As a form of tabarra. Why? Because Shimr bin al-Joshan tried to pull off the hijab of the daughter of Rasulullah. But what if my wife doesn't wear hijab? Or what if I, who send la'na, do not wear hijab? There are many of the daughters of Al-Muhammad today who send la'na on Shimr because he took off the hijab of the daughters of Rasulullah. But what if you yourself are not wearing hijab? What's the point of sending la'na on him? The aim of la'na was that the person you ask Allah to withdraw the mercy from should be someone who you are not copying in your lifestyle. But if I'm copying that exact person, my daughter wants to wear hijab, I tell her, no, stay away from hijab, stay away. You become religious later. Then what's the point of me doing la'na on the man who hurt the daughters of Rasulullah? When the la'na should rebound on me, that's why some of you will see in Sham, some people go on a ziyarah to Bab al-Saghir. When they go to visit the graveyard, you find some people pick up a rock and throw it on the grave of a certain personality. One of these people, when he threw the stone, it rebounded back on him. And I told him, I'm afraid you two might be involved in the same world. Meaning what? Meaning sometimes the la'na may rebound on us. But then there is a second group of people who say there's no need for la'na. Why? Because they say the people you are asking Allah to withdraw His mercy from, maybe they ask for forgiveness later on. As in, maybe they change later on. Some people come forward and say, therefore, you shouldn't do la'na on Yazid. Why? Because maybe Yazid asked for forgiveness later on. A piece of Persian poetry explains this the best. They tell me, do not do la'na on Yazid because Allah may forgive Yazid. Therefore, I do double the la'na. Why? Because if Allah is willing to forgive Yazid for killing Aba Abdullah, then He'll forgive me for doing la'na on Yazid. Therefore, those who come forward and say they may have asked for forgiveness, don't worry about it. We'll continue and we'll meet on the Day of Judgment. Therefore, the first type of tabarra which is valid is the dua by the name of la'na. The second type of tabarra which is valid is to write your tabarra. Meaning what? Meaning I wish those people who done la'na on all these personalities would write one book about these people's lives. Just one book. As in, the ink of the scholar is greater than the blood of the martyr. Meaning that when you perform tabarra, don't just do it as lip service. Go and write about what the enemies of Al-Muhammad did to them. Write about them. Because a person who is an orphan according to the sixth imam is not one without a mother or a father, is one without literature, Meaning what? Meaning that when I perform tabarra, the second best way after reciting a dua by the name of La'na is for me to write books about the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. Many of our people do not know anything about those who hurt Al Muhammad. Many of us do not have the books available. In many cases, those books are in Arabic. There is a need for us to write as a form of tabarra. That's why may Allah bless Allama Al-Hilli. May Allah bless him. Allama Al-Hilli dedicated his life with his finger in writing for the cause of Al Muhammad. That you cannot graduate from the Hawza of Qum or Najaf without reading through Allama Al-Hilli's works. Allama Al-Hilli was revered not only by his own school, but by all other schools in Islam, to the extent that there was a alim of another school in Islam, who I don't want to mention his name, who was a man whose tongue could be vicious sometimes and vile. His tongue would be vile except against Allama Al-Hilli. He'd say Allama Al-Hilli, or to his exact words, Hilli is a knowledgeable person. Therefore, I will not be vile towards him. This alim wrote a book where he attacked the position of Ahlul Bayt. And in this book, he's damning against the position of Fatima. He attacks it completely. Everybody wanted access to his book in the time of Allama Al-Hilli. Nobody got access to it. He said, the only person I'll allow access to it is Hilli, because he's a man of knowledge. But only for one night he can keep it. How many nights? One night. He can keep it, do what he wants with it. I want it back in the morning. Allama Al-Hilli, look at the sacrifice of this pen. The Shia of Al-Muhammad in the year 2008, some of them haven't read, let alone written. Whereas you find Allama Al-Hilli takes the book. Do you know what he thinks? He thinks, I can copy everything and answer it now. No. He thinks, let me just copy what he's written in his book, word for word. Then I'll write a reply to what he's written. What did Allama Al-Hilli do? He started writing and writing and writing. But imagine, he's only got one night. He's picked it up in the evening. He's got to bring it back in the morning. He's writing and writing. And like many of you who know, those of you who've revised for exams will know, you get to that period of 3-4 o'clock in the morning. And that's when we start dozing off slowly. And so what happens was, he was writing and writing. He fell asleep. When he woke up, he realized the time was that he had to go and give it back to the alim. Yet at the same time, what did he realize? He realized he had not finished his work. Because when he woke up, he felt sad that I could have copied this book and replied in tabarra for the cause of Ahlul Bayt. But I'm not able to. So he looked at where he had stopped. He suddenly came to that page where he had stopped. He realized there was another page after it. He flicked to the next page. He realized there's another page written. And another page. And another page. And another page. Until he realized that the whole book had been copied, and that at the bottom of the last page, a signature, Al-Mahdi Al-Hujjat ibn al-Hasan. In that our 12th Imam helped him in his cause of dissociation from the enemies of Ahlul Bayt. That sometimes many of us do not think that when we write, there is a service being provided by Allah through the Imam of Al-Muhammad. He wrote and he wrote, he couldn't finish. The Imam helped him finish. Therefore, the second form of tabarra was to write. Write about those people who hurt Al-Muhammad, who annoyed Al-Muhammad. Let the world out there learn. There are many who don't even know about the atrocities Ahlul Bayt faced. The third form of tabarra is using your tongue to perform tabarra. Amir al-Mu'mineen says about the tongue, he says, جُرْمُهُ صَغِيرٌ وَجُرْمُهُ ثَقِيلٌ. The weight of the tongue of the human being is so small. If you were to take out your tongue and put it on the weighing scales, it may not weigh more than 3-4 grams. But he said the power of the human tongue is so devastating that there are people whose tongue is so light, but it is so devastating they can take you to a river and bring you back thirsty. Meaning what? Meaning that there are people, their tongue, they can twist you in circles with their tongue. Yet when Allah created the tongue, the aim of that tongue was to do what? Was to perform tabarra, to speak out against injustice. That when you see injustice, use tabarra, dissociate from those people.